तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं वंदेहं श्री गुरु श्रीयुता पदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणी हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यः कृपासिन्धुभ्यः च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंदा श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे Hare Krishna. So welcome back to our Tuesday and Thursday seminars on Vaishnav Ninda. We have been quite long discussing Bhaktivinoda Thakur's analysis of who is a Vaishnava from the Bhagavad perspective and who is a Vaishnava from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's perspective. So last time one devotee asked, Prabhuji, this text is discussing about Vaishnava Ninda, but so much discussion about, the Bhagavad perspective of a Vaishnava and the Chaitanya Charitamrita perspective of Vaishnava and so much quotations. Looks like the subject is going off track. So that is what one of the devotees was saying. And if we have observed, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is making a very in-depth analysis because he began his essay by defining what is actually Vaishnava Ninda, the six offenses, aparadhas. And he said that because Vaishnava aparadha is so dangerous, so detrimental, so first let us analyze who is a Vaishnava and what constitutes Vaishnav Aparadh. Now, who is a Vaishnava? To understand, that is why Bhaktivinoda Thakur discussed quite in detail. He did a very, very systematic analysis from the Bhagavad perspective. And then he did a very systematic analysis from the Chaitanya Charitamrita based on Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's analysis of Kanishta, Uttama, and Madhyama, or Vaishnava, Vaishnavatara, and Vaishnava Uttama. So anyone once who takes a name of Krishna, he's a Vaishnava. And maybe in his lifetime, once he might take one Shuddhanam. So he's a Vaishnava. One who's taking Nirantar Shuddhanam, he's Vaishnavatara. And one who is able to inspire others to take Shuddhanam, is Vaishnavatama or Vaishnav Pradhan. So this is how in-depth Bhaktivinoda Thakur is going into this understanding and analysis of who is a Vaishnava. Who is a Vaishnava? He's going into this analysis. Now we are coming to the subject. So now we have done this analysis from the Bhagavad vision and from Chaitanya Charitamrita vision. So let us now go into the next topic. The topic is developing very, very systematically. So we are not anywhere off track. So let us now just recap what we discussed. There's a long discussion which has happened now. The first one was three types of Vaishnavas according to Srimad Bhagavatam. And then three classifications of Vaishnava according to teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Vaishnava, Vaishnavatara and Vaishnavatama. And after discussing all this, then a small topic which we discussed in the last class, the difference between Nama and Namabhas. Namabhas means it is the Abhas, it is the reflection of the name. But Nam means actually it is pure name. So briefly, Bhaktivinoda Thakur dealt what is the difference between Nam and Namabhas. And he said, this is not the subject here, I will deal with somewhere else. But we, a little in depth, we went into it also. What is Namaprad, Namabhasya and Shuddha Nam. So I came across in one purport of Bhagavatam today itself, Prabhupada says there are three stages of chanting. The offensive stage, the reflective stage and the offenseless stage. I am repeating here. The offensive stage, the reflective stage and the offenseless stage. Now many devotees might have been aware of the terminologies we use for Namaprad, Namabhas and Shuddhanam. We usually use the terminologies offensive chanting, offenseless chanting and pure chanting. But it is interesting, Prabhupada uses the term offensive chanting, reflective chanting and then offenseless chanting. So offenseless chanting is actually pure name. So Nam means pure name. Namabhas means it is just the abhas of the name. It is not fully pure. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur has dealt just in one small topic this, that really one who takes the name, he is chanting the pure name. Otherwise it is just the Nama, just the name coming out, but it is not the holy name. Nam akshar matra lay, nam na loy. As you know, in one of his sayings is that nam akshar matra lay. Only the names are coming out, but the letters of the name are coming out, but not the name. So when he says nam, nam means pure name. So that's how he has dealt this one topic, which we saw in the last class. So now after dealing with this topic of Namabhas and Nam, now Bhaktivinoda Thakur speaks about the next theme, that is the Vaishnava who chants Shuddha Nam is endowed with all good qualities, is free of sins and has no interest in pious or impious activities. Now this Vaishnava who chants Shuddha Nam might be a Vaishnava who chants once the name of Shuddha Nam, that is a Kanishtha, or his Nirantar Namlai or a Madhyama, or who is able to give pure name to others and inspire or instill Bhakti Shakti in others, that is the Mahabhagavat. So it can refer to all three. So here it is referring to all three. So let us see this very important theme now to understand who is a Vaishnava. He is a Vaishnava, he is endowed with all good qualities and is free from sins, both pious and impious. Let us see what Bhaktivinoda Thakur has to say. Vaishnava sabhavata sarva gurna sampano oi sarva dosha vivarjita chaitanyamrita. In Chaitanya Charitamrita it is mentioned A Vaishnava is naturally endowed with all auspicious qualities. Vaishnava svabhavata sarva gurna sampad. O sarva dosh, and free from all defects. So this is the second point to be noted. Vaishnava has all good auspicious qualities and is free from all defects. And then he says it is mentioned in Charitamrita, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. And here the quotation is there. Sarva gana, sarva maha guna gana, Vaishnava sharire, Krishna bhakte krishnera, guna sakala sanchare. All great transcendental qualities are present in the bodies of Vaishnavas. Vaishnava sharire, sarva mana guna, maha guna, great qualities, gana. Gana means the many qualities. All of Lord Krishna's qualities appear in the devotees of Lord Krishna. Krishna bhakte krishnera guna sakala sanchare. So all the qualities of Krishna appear in his pure devotees, in his devotees. Vidhi dharma chadi bhaje krishnera charana nishiddha papachara tara kabuna mane. Such a devotee who has these qualities, who is a Vaishnava, giving up the regulative principles of Varna and Ashram institution, Vidhi Dharma Chadi, he worships the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. Krishnera Bhajan, Bhajet Krishnera Charan, Nishiddha Papachar Tara Kabuna, Kabunahe Mane. His mind is never attracted to forbidden and sinful activities. So his mind is not at all attracted to perform on any sinful activities. Agenoi hoy yadi pap upasthita. Even if out of ignorance there are sinful activities present in him, even if they are present, what does Bhaktivinoda Thakur say? Krishna tara shuddha krena na taraya prashrita ahimsa niyamadi bhule Krishna sangha. Lord Krishna purifies that devotee, Krishna tara shuddha karena, and does not cause him to perform atonement. Na karaye prashrit. There is no need to perform any prashrit of the karma kanda rituals. Ahimsa niyamadi bhule Krishna sangha. Non-violence. Non-violence is ahimsa. Scriptural restrictions. Niyamadi. And so on. Roam. You know, bhule means they roam. They are behind him in the association of a devotee of the Lord. So the devotee separately doesn't cultivate these qualities of ahimsa and all these, you know, scriptural restrictions. All of them just are roaming behind him. Just like when a minister is going, behind him is the secretary and his, you know, all his servants, they are just roaming behind him. So similarly, all these qualities need not be separately cultivated. They all roam behind the devotee. Asat sangatyag. A Vaishnava Achar, Stri Sangi Ek Asadu, Krishna Bhakta Ar. Rejection of the association of unsaintly persons, Atat Sangatyag, is the characteristic behavior of a Vaishnava. A Vaishnava Achar. So, who is a Vaishnava Achar? Who is a Vaishnava? What is his conduct? He gives up Asat Sangatyag. One who associates with women for sense gratification, Stri Sangi Eka, is an unsaintly person. One who is not a devotee of Lord Krishna, Asadhu, Krishna Abhakta R, is another unsaintly person. So, Krishna Sangi Eka Asadhu. You know, if he is associates with some, he is an unsaintly person, and he is, you know, one who is not a devotee is an unsaintly person. So, two kinds of Asat Sangha is to be avoided. One who associates with women for sense gratification, that kind of asatsang to be given, and one who is not a devotee. And this is the Vaishnav Achar. So here Bhaktivinoda Thakur has quoted now few verses to mention how in a Vaishnava all the wonderful qualities are there. So what is that? One, he has mentioned all these wonderful qualities are there. Something went wrong. Just a second. And then, this is the quality. He doesn't practice. He gives up all regularity principles. He is not attracted to do forbidden activities or sinful activities. And even if there are sinful activities present in him, Krishna purifies him. And all these wonderful qualities run behind him. They roam behind him. And then this is his foremost quality, that he is free from asatsang. Men who are attached to women for sense gratification, and there are people who are abhakta, who are not deities. He avoids them. So these are the qualities which are there in the Vaishnava. So now Bhaktivinoda Thakur has quoted these verses from the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So let us again go through these verses as to what Prabhupada has to say about it in his commentary. Same verses again I am taking from Chaitanya Charitamrita. This is there in the footnotes of the book Vaishnava Ninda as an appendix. So I picked up from there only. A Vaishnava, Vaishnava Sharire, is one who has developed all good transcendental qualities. Sarva Maha Guna Gana. Sarva Maha Guna Gana Vaishnava Sharire, as it is mentioned. All the good qualities of Krishna gradually develop. Krishna Bhakte Krishnera Guna Sakala Sanchari. In a devotee's, in Krishna's devotees, in Krishna Bhakti, Krishna Bhakti. So here is a wonderful description and translation of Prabhupada. He's saying that all the good qualities of Krishna develop gradually. Now, I want to ask here in the forum, everyone, how many of us feel as devotees that, you know, we see Vaishnavas, but we don't see good qualities. There are no good qualities in this Vaishnavas. You know, sometimes we feel that they don't have these qualities. And genuinely, I'm asking, how many of us feel that there are some bad qualities also in the Vaishnava? Then what is mentioned in this verse, it's difficult to find in Vaishnavas. How many of you genuinely feel, you can type in the chat box? Or sometimes you feel that, oh, sometimes these outside people have good qualities of compassion and being humble and gentle in their behavior, in their talk. And sometimes these Vaishnavas are rough, you know, to deal. Sometimes, you know, they talk very loudly or rudely, harshly. But sometimes outside people are very soft to talk. They are very gentle in their dealings. So how many of you feel like this? You can sincerely type in the chat box. How many of you feel like this? Any response? Okay. So there is one response. Yes, I feel that. I feel like that sometimes. Yes. I feel we too need to develop good qualities. Yes, yes. Please type it in the chat box. I would like to see in the chat box. Could you please reframe the question? The question is that this verse is mentioning that all the good qualities reside in the Vaishnava. Whatever Krishna's qualities are there, those qualities are there in the Vaishnava. Mahan Gun, all these good qualities are there in the Vaishnava. And Mahan Gun, all these qualities are there. But we feel sometimes that sometimes Vaishnavas, you know, they are not having these good qualities, like they don't behave properly, or they are very rude and rough and rash like this. Or sometimes we feel that the outside people, sometimes we see they are very gentle in their speech. They are, you know, very good in their dealings. They are very soft spoken, you know, but sometimes we see there are Vaishnavas who don't behave properly. They are very rough and rude. So we see these things. So in the association of Vaishnavas, how many of us feel that, no, we don't see these kind of good qualities, what is really mentioned in this verse? So that was the question. Yes, that is, you know, I feel, yeah. So frankly speaking, honestly also, sometimes, yes, even I do feel like that, you know, in the Vaishnava Samaj, in the association of devotees, sometimes some Vaishnavas, you know, don't have these qualities what is mentioned by Krishna. There is one answer. Every devotee has some good qualities in them, and we need to identify them, and any negative quality we need to deal with it as a devotee. Okay. Yes, I feel sometimes we should practice to change our perception to see good qualities and nurture ourselves. Yes. Now, my only question was not to do that analysis, but how many of us just feel that, yes, in devotees, we don't see these good qualities, what is being mentioned. That's it. How many of us feel yes or no? That was the question. Yeah, many are giving a very positive and a frank answer. And that is what I had also expected. Now, let us go a little in depth and try to understand this very, very important thing. So here in this yes, so it's good. I have got a very good response. I'm very happy about it. Now, some of my system has not been working properly. It's got hanged up. Give me a minute. Let me sort this out. Hand out. Yeah. So the quote also given for this by Prabhupada is, I will just have to reopen the PowerPoint. Give me a minute at least, please. Yes, okay. So now let us come back to the verse of Chaitanya Charitamrit. Yes. So there is one more, some message. Avagun are more visible than good qualities. Yes, 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 yes. Let us now see. Now from a Vaishnava perspective, let us see these things now. This verse is saying that all Mahan Guna Gana Vaishnava Sharir, all great qualities, wonderful qualities develop in a Vaishnava. And Krishna Bhakte Krishna Ragun, that too Krishna's qualities, Sakali, you can develop. Now here one thing, if you have noted in the translation, Prabhupada, and I have marked it, all the good qualities of Krishna gradually develop, it is mentioned. So this is one thing to be noted. And let us see what Prabhupada has to say about this. Now, Prabhupada doesn't say anything in this purport, but he quotes a verse that there is this verse which is mentioned in the Bhagavatam. So the next verse of Chaitanya Charitamrita 75, this is 76. And here it is mentioned, Yasyasti Bhaktir Bhagavatya Kanchana Sarver Gunastatra Samasate Sura Harava Bhaktasya Kuto Mahat Guna Manorate nasati dhavato bahi. In one who yasya asti has unflinching devotional faith in Krishna, bhaktir bhagavati akinchana. So one who is practicing devotional service, unflinching devotional service, means he is having faith only in Krishna bhakti and not in any devata bhakti or any other bhakti. He is only practicing Krishna bhakti. Of course, his faith will slowly, slowly become stronger and stronger, and you become Naishtik Bhakti. That's no doubt about it. All the good qualities of Krishna and the demigods are consistently manifest. Sarver Gunes Tatra Samasate Sura. So here one misunderstanding we have, sometimes we think Sura refers to the demigods. So if all the qualities of the demigods come in the devotee, because the demigods are also part of this material world. So what's so great? Even the devata worshippers who worship the devatas, they will get the qualities of the devatas. So what's so special about the pure devotees or the devotees who are practicing unflinching devotion? So Sura here refers to actually Krishna, because Krishna is Swayam Bhagwan and all the devatas are his part and parcels who are part of the administrative demigods. So here good qualities means all the good qualities which are there in Krishna and as well as the demigods. It doesn't just refer to the demigods. This is one point to be noted. However, he who has no devotion to the Supreme Personality of Godhead has no good qualifications. Harava abhaktyasya kuto mahadguna. There is no good qualification at all. This verse is saying. Why? Because he is engaged by mental concoction in material existence, which is the external feature of the Lord. The reason is mano raten asati dhavato bahi. He is sitting on the manarat. And his shelter is what? Asat. This is asat. This world is asat. And he is wandering dhavato bahi in the external potency of the Lord. So here, this verse is very, very important for us to understand. So I'll give you now two examples. Here is one person. He was from a previous life coming to devotional service. He was coming from a very, very degraded background. He might have been a meat eater or he might be a hunter also. So he must be have been in the most degraded consciousness, the tamasic consciousness, the mode of ignorance. He takes up to devotional service. And there is another person out in the material world. He is not a devotee, but he is having nice qualities. Like he's very charitable. He's very soft spoken. He eats only sattvic foods which are vegetarian. He's a vegan. He's a promoter of vegetarianism. So this person is very good in his dealings. He has very nice behavior. He's well spoken. He has nice dealings with people. And he's also attractive. The other person A, his background is very bad because he was a hunter previously, but he has taken to devotional service. And now as he has taken up to devotional service, he's chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra. He has given up his previous bad habits. Now, because of his conditioning, he sometimes have to struggle with his previous conditionings to give up maybe, smoking or to give up, addiction for drinking, something like that, while practicing devotional life. So for him to give up some of the, regulative principles, to follow those regulative principles might be a challenge. He's battling, to eat only prasadam, because sometimes he's being influenced by the lower modes and he's battling that. This other person who's having coming from a very good background, he is having very sattvic impressions. And he did not battle to give up meat. He doesn't take meat at all. He's only attracted to sattvic food. So for him, there is no struggle because he's having sattvic impressions. He's more good. Whereas the other person is practicing bhakti, but influenced by the mode of ignorance because of his previous conditioning. And he is battling to practice devotion. In these externally perceived devotees, sometimes he is while practicing. But he is a complete this is now. Is it audible? Is it audible now? Yeah, fine. Okay. So we were discussing about two cases. We were discussing about two cases. One is of the person who had come from a very previous bad background, a sinful background. Maybe he is a hunter and he has taken up to Krishna consciousness. Now to practice the do's and don'ts of regulative principles of devotional service, he is battling very hard. And sometimes he might succumb to, you know, his previous habits. Whereas the other B person, he's born with sattvic impressions, he's attracted to the mode of goodness, he likes naturally vegetarian food, and he has natural distaste for non-veg food or tamasic food. The first one who has taken up to devotional service, although he is, you know, battling to give up his previous conditioned habits, Krishna is seeing that struggle and Krishna is pleased. Whereas the second person who is with sattvic impressions, he is not practicing devotional service. He is just caught up in raga and dvesh, which are part of this material world. So he has natural attraction for vegetarian food and natural distaste, dvesh, for non-veg food. So there is no battle for him to give up non-veg because naturally he is attracted to sattvic impressions. So he is still under raga and dvesh, the second person. Whereas this devotee who is coming from a previous very bad background, he is battling to follow Krishna's instructions given in the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, and the Nectar of Devotion and Nectar of Instructions, following the regulative principles. And he is struggling to maintain that. Krishna is seeing that and Krishna is pleased with that. This is one point to be noted with respect to this verse. So there are good qualities in the Vaishnavas and these qualities slowly manifest. So in the sadhana bhakti, the first stage is kleshagni and the second stage is shubhada. Although both of these things manifest simultaneously, the kleshagni and shubhada happen, one thing we should know, that when one takes to devotional service, what is happening is he has now this one good quality, that he is a devotee. He has left meat eating, illicit sex, intoxication, gambling, which itself is very, very great thing. Even if somebody can leave tea and coffee, it's not an easy thing, especially somebody who's conditioned for many years to take tea and coffee. So we should, in the beginning stages of our spiritual life, see these important qualities in a Vaishnava. Before, he might have been a, you know, chain smoker, or he might have been addicted to eating non-veg. He has given up that. He might be addicted to drinking alcohol. He is able to give up and take to Vaishnavism. So that is a good quality we should see in the Vaishnavas. That is very important in the beginning stages. Now, secondly, regarding all these Mahaguna, these slowly start appearing in the body of a Vaishnava after Kleshagni has happened, and then Shubhada. Shubhada is auspicious qualities. Auspicious qualities refer to the qualities like Dainya, humility, Daya, compassion, you know, and Akrodha means no anger. So all these qualities, there are many qualities which are mentioned, all these qualities slowly, slowly manifest after bhajan kriya when one is at the stage of nishtha. So if we are trying to see these spiritual qualities develop at a later stage in our spiritual life. And before anarth nivritti has happened, there might be conditionings. And these conditionings, a sadhaka is struggling to overcome these conditionings. So we should see that quality, that he has this conditionings, he has this nature, but he is trying to overcome them. And he is endeavoring, and Krishna is pleased with that endeavor. And he has given up asatsang tyag, and he has taken up, you know, to Vaishnavism. He has given up tea and coffee. So these kind of good qualities also you should see in the beginning devotees. And definitely all these qualities, what Krishna is mentioning, or what, you know, the scriptures mention, they gradually develop. So Shubhada, with Shubhada, Shubhada happens gradually. The first auspiciousness thing which happens is he takes up to Vaishnavism, he gives up association of non-devotees, he gives up tea and coffee. These are all Shubhada in one sense, you know. So this we should see as devotees. This is the lens by which we should see, you know, in the association of Vaishnavas. And sometimes we see these other qualities because of their conditioning. This we should neglect, because ultimately, by practicing bhakti, when anarth nivritti happens, all these wonderful qualities will slowly, slowly manifest. So it's a question of time. So that is why, although these other bad qualities may be there in the body of a Vaishnava, but they will be soonly eradicated by his practice of Krishna consciousness. So with this kind of understanding, we should deal with Vaishnavas, and that's how we should be in the association of Vaishnavas. So these are the two examples which I gave, make it very clear of one with a very degraded background takes up to Krishna consciousness, and one in the outside world having very good qualities, but he's attracted to sattvic impressions and naturally has distaste for tamasic impressions. And he has also some good qualities, but he has not taken up to Krishna consciousness. He will stay in the material world. And slowly, in his next life, the sattva will not remain. Slowly, you know, the other impressions, rajasic and tamasic impressions, will come, and slowly, slowly he will degrade. So he cannot maintain that sattva guna. Whereas this devotee, taking up to devotional service itself is transcendental, bhakti is nirgun. Slowly, slowly he will overcome his conditionings which are there in the heart with the anarth nivritti, and ultimately he will attain the Lord. So in that sense, the first case of a person with a very bad background taking up to devotion, he has all these qualities. So that is what this verse is saying. Yastyasti bhaktir bhagavati akinchana sarver gunestatra samasatesura. So this, we should have firm faith in this statement. And we should see, even though in the outside world, we might find all wonderful qualities, but still we should have faith in the statement that they are abhakta, and in abhakta there are no good qualities. Kuto mahat gunat. Maybe the greatest person on this planet earth, you know, whole world might be glorifying him, but still if he is abhakta, kuto mahat gunat, there are no good qualities, because he is on the mental platform. He is completely caught in raga and dvesh. So this is how we should understand. So the next verse which Bhaktivinoda Thakur had quoted, this is there in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. Although the pure devotee does not follow all the regulative principles of Varnashram, Vidhi Dharma Chadi, he worships the lotus feet of Krishna, Bhaje Krishna Racharan. Therefore, he naturally has no tendency to commit sin. Nishiddha Papachar Tara Kabuna Mane. So the purpose of Varnashram, Prabhupada explains, is that people should not commit sin. That is the reason. But one who takes to Krishna consciousness, he is naturally not having any inclination to commit sin. So that's how superior is Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada in his purport explains, the Varnashram institution is planned in such a way that one will not commit sinful activities. Material existence continues due to sinful activity. When one acts sinfully in this life, he gets a suitable body for the next life. When one again acts sinfully, he takes up another material body. In this way, one is continuously under the influence of material nature. Purusha prakriti stohi bhongte prakritim jnan gunan karana guna sangasya Shraddha Sadyo Nijanmasu. This is from 13.22. Due to our association with the modes of material nature, we get different types of bodies, good and bad. One cannot be liberated from the cycle of birth and death, known as transmigration of soul, unless one is completely freed from all sinful activities. So as long as one is not free from all sinful activities, one cannot become free from the cycle of birth and death. The best process, therefore, is to take off Krishna consciousness. One cannot take to Krishna consciousness without being freed from all sinful activities. So here is a very important point, and I would like to know again from the devotees, Prabhupada is referring to which verse from the Bhagavad Gita? You can type in the chat box. Which verse of the Bhagavad Gita Prabhupada is quoting, referring here in this statement? I'll show the statement once again. One cannot take to Krishna consciousness without being free from all sinful activities. There is one answer. Yes, Esham tu antagatam papam jananam punya karmanam te dvanda moha nirmukta bhajante mam dridavrata. So because all the antagata papa has become, one has taken to Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada says that. This is one way of understanding that verse. And of course, when we can practice Naishtiki Bhakti, Bhakti with lot of determination, with deep determination, at the stage of Nishta, one is highly determined to practice devotional service with very, very strong determination. There also this verse, Hare Krishna. Is the audio clear? Is the audio clear? Yeah. I don't know whether to continue or no, because looks like my system has got crashed. So what do you suggest? Should we wind up? Because, you know, take Q&A. Okay, let us take to Q&A till, you know, system works, because looks like, you know, I've just started the session and we are not, I wanted to finish this session because next session was a very important session. And this has been happening since morning that my system has crashed and I thought it was resolved, but looks like it is not resolved. So I'll take up the questions as it goes. So I'll take up the question first. Maya Narasimha Prabhu has a question. Yes, Prabhuji.
Prabhuji, Hare Krishna. Devotee message just now, it is becoming very interesting and exciting as you are progressing. But I have one question here. I'm sure that you are going to address it. It is related to the last statement which you have made, that Yesham Tvam Antagatam Papam Jananam Punya Karmanam. There, Lord Krishna is telling that. I think that is talking about Dudavrata, means he cannot practice the devotion with the determination. But in other words, Krishna is telling that Mamki Partha Vyapashrita Eapishu Papa Yoneyo. In that verse, he is including even the souls, those who are very impious. Mm-hmm. And bhakti is not dependent on previous punya and papa. Rather, it is dependent on bhakti sukruti. So, are you going to address this point, Prabhu, that until unless we do not become free from sinful activities, so we cannot take to Krishna consciousness, doesn't appeal to us because we are not pure, but still we have got this opportunity to take up chanting.
I still did not get exactly what is your correlation. What is the correlation you did?
Correlation what I did is that this Esham Tvam Antagatam Papam Jananam Punya Karmanam Tedbandva Moha Nirmukto Bhajantimam Drudavratha. So this verse is talking about devotees practicing with determination. They cannot practice devotion with determination until unless they are free from sinful reactions. That's what is understanding. But in other words, Krishna is telling that Mamhi Partha Vyapachrita Eapishu Papa Yoneyo. So there he is saying that even the people, those who are born in impious yonis, they can also take up to devotional service. Yeah. So bhakti is not limiting, it is only to those who are free from sinful reactions.
Yes, see, this is a, and you know, for practicing jnana or ashtanga, there is purification of the heart required. One should be completely pure at heart. Completely pure means, you know, there are different degrees there. One should be at least a self-realized soul. So there is purity of heart as a prerequisite for practicing jnana or ashtanga. And for taking up to karma, also there is a certain level of purity required. That is knowledge, purity in terms of knowledge that, you know, I should not do actions with attachment to the results, because those actions bind me. I should do actions for liberation. So these are all the Vedic paths which are given. The path of Varnashram, where there is Karma Yoga, then Karma Yoga to Jnana Yoga, Jnana Yoga to Ashtanga Yoga, and then ultimately liberation. But the path of Bhakti, pure devotion, doesn't depend on any of these criterias. Bhakti Devi is completely transcendental, and it can appear in a person whose heart is also sinful, whose heart is not free from lust. But for a jnani, you know, if his heart is, you know, impure, he cannot practice the jnana marga. He has to come back to karma kanda, karma yoga. So bhakti, that is why that is the glory of bhakti. And in the ninth chapter, Krishna is bringing out that glory of bhakti, that how glorious is pure devotional service, that maybe from any background, anyone who is, if they take up shelter of Bhakti Devi, they take shelter of pure devotees, they can ultimately... Hare Krishna. So I feel that it's better that we wind up. But I'll just finish this question. So there in seventh chapter, the Sukrutinas who take up shelter of Krishna, these are not, they are called as Mishra Bhaktas actually. The Karma Mishra, the Jnana Mishra, and the Yoga Mishra Bhaktas. So Krishna is explaining about that there in the seventh chapter. And Krishna also explained those who don't surrender to him, but to surrender to the demigods in the seventh chapter 20 to 23. And he's also speaking about those who surrender to the Brahman. Avyakta Vyakti Mapanna. They surrender to the impersonal. They take shelter of the impersonal. And then why? Because they are covered by the Yoga Maya. And because they are covered by the Yoga Maya, Naham Prakasha Sarvasya. And they are ruled by what? Icha Dvesha Samuttena. So when this moha will go on, eshamtu antagatam papam. So in that flow, this verse is coming. So how we see this verse will depend on what context we will be referring. So Prabhupada is referring in that purport that one who has taken up to devotional life, he's already pure, in fact. Just taking up to devotional life, he's pure. This is also one understanding we should have. Secondly, another understanding is that one will become free from anarth nivritti when, I'm free from my past sinful and pious activities. That is, kleshagni has happened and shubhada has come out. So at the stage of nishta, one will be able to practice dridha vrata bhakti, or what is called as Naishti ki bhakti. He's able to practice nishtita bhajan kriya. But before anartha nivritti, his bhajan kriya is anishtita because his heart is not pure and anarthas are troubling him. So in this way, we should see in what context we apply that particular verse. Now, this verse overrides when Krishna in the 18th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita says, man mana bhav mad vakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mam evashi satyam te pratijano si priyosami. Oh Arjuna, you are very dear to me. Priyosimi. Because you are very dear to me, do this. Man mana mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru. And then he's saying, mam evashi satyam te. I am telling you the truth, that you will come to me. Because you are very dear to me. Arjuna might hesitate and say, what about, my conditionings? If I have sinful reactions, don't worry, I will take care of it. And that is what Krishna is saying. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja aham tvam sarva papyabhyo mokshasyami mahasucha. So Krishna is slowly bringing out the bhakti, devotional glories of bhakti progressively in the Bhagavad Gita. So just like the mother sees a child, the child has passed stool and urine, he is very dirty, but still the mother will call him and she'll embrace him, wash him and clean him and, take care of him. Similarly, Krishna, if we feel that, I'm dirty. But Krishna, if he calls and Krishna wants to, take care of all our sins, if we are ready to surrender, then why we should worry about the sins? So in that sense, Krishna is speaking out of love there. Just like the mother out of the love, she doesn't see the impurities of the child, the urine and stool he has passed. She will call the child, embrace him and caress him and take care of him. So Krishna is developing that theme, and ultimately the pinnacle of how Krishna has love for his devotee, he is bringing forth in 18.64 and 65, and then ultimately in 18.66. So like that, we'll have to see the flow in the Gita. So I'm extremely sorry because even I am feeling a little awkward because the discussion which is happening, the flow is getting interrupted because of this internet issue. So what do you suggest? We take questions till again the internet gives some trouble, or what do we do? Yeah, there is one question by one Mataji. Yadurani Kalindi Devidasi. I don't know, they are not in the group, but how they got this connection. But anyway, you can send the details to me. I will include in the group. You can send a WhatsApp number. If devotees does mistake or offense, mistakes are different and offense is different. So let us take it as offense to Vaishnava. And even after begging forgiveness, if reactions are working of losing the taste for chanting, does this lead to fall down in Krishna consciousness? Yes. Now, moment we, you know, the Vaishnava Aparad will come up. Bhaktivinoda Thakur is going to discuss now. After discussing, this is Vaishnava who has all these qualities. And seeing defects in a Vaishnava or criticizing a Vaishnava because of his past conditioning before coming to Krishna consciousness, or the traces or impurities which are there, you see, find faults with that. That what is constitutes aparadh. That is what Bhaktivinoda Thakur is going to come in the discussion, but we were not able to go there. But since this question has asked, so when we find faults with Vaishnavas, you know, and that time we, it constitutes an aparadh. And the moment we realize that we have committed an offense, Vishwanath Chakra Thakur tells us three measures we need to do. First is, we should regret that how fallen I am, how degraded I am, that such and such Vaishnava, I did this offense, aparadh. And because of my offense, this Vaishnava, you know, his heart is burning. Now I should burn in the fire of repentance. As long as I don't genuinely burn in the fire of repentance and then approach the Vaishnava to ask forgiveness, that forgiveness will not work. And in Ayurveda, it is said that when there is a burn in the skin, and Ayurvedic medicines, they give a burning ointment only. So the burn can burn the burnt part and heal it. So similarly, we should burn in the fire of repentance first. Genuinely go and ask forgiveness to that Vaishnava. And Vaishnavas are genuinely humble and sincere and honest, and they will easily forgive. Suppose the Vaishnava offense is such severe offense that the Vaishnava's heart is not pacified, then we should sincerely try to serve him. And in spite of serving for a long time, still that Vaishnava's heart is not pacified, then we should not come to this conclusion, oh, in the Bhagavatam, yasyasti bhaktir bhagavati akinchana, Vaishnava is compassionate, a Vaishnava has all these wonderful qualities, but this Vaishnava doesn't have these qualities. So why I should, you know, demean myself and go and beg, you know, forgiveness from him? You know, he is not a Vaishnava because he doesn't have these qualities. If you come to such a monglic conclusion, then you are committing greater aparadh. This is one thing to be understood. So in spite of serving that Vaishnava, still that Vaishnava's anger doesn't come down, then what should be our mood? Our mood should not be that this Vaishnava doesn't have good qualities and neglected. No, our mood should be that I'm such a fallen and degraded person that, you know, I don't have these good qualities, and it is my, you know, grievous offense which has, you know, led this situation. So what I should do? Then I should take Nirantar holy name. In a repentful heart, one has to take shelter of the holy name, and by the mercy of the holy name, you know, he will become free from this aparadh. So one need not, you know, directly, oh, I have committed an offense. So if I go and take shelter of the holy name, and by holy name's mercy, I'll become free from the aparadh. If he does that, in fact, if he takes directly that, you know, fourth option, then what will happen? He will become more implicated in sin. Namo baladi yasya papa buddhi. That will become another nama prath. So the first step is that one should first burn in the fire of repentance. Then one should go and genuinely ask forgiveness. And if the Vaishnava is satisfied and forgives, then the problem is solved there. But if he is not satisfied still, then one should repeatedly go and ask forgiveness. Still, if his heart is not pacified, then one should serve him and try to please him, endeavor and serve to please him. And in spite of all this, when nothing works out, you know, then one should not come to a conclusion, oh, this Vaishnava doesn't have good qualities. Why should beg forgiveness? No, one should regret and lament for himself and then take shelter of the holy name. And in this consciousness, chant Nirantar the holy name. Then by the Naam Prabhu's mercy, we become free from that apradh. So that is the solution. I hope this answer is clear and satisfactory to you, Mataji. Okay, is there any?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you so much for addressing.
Any other questions anyone has? There are many new devotees here in the group who are not here and registered in the course, Vaishnava Ninda. I don't know how they got these details. If you want, you can send the WhatsApp number to me so that I can send you all the details of the sessions. So I have typed my WhatsApp number. Any other questions? I would not like to continue the discussion because the flow of thought will get interrupted. Please send me a WhatsApp number because I cannot follow in the chat. Just send me a WhatsApp number later on. I have sent my WhatsApp number. Any other questions anyone has can raise their hands. Any other questions? Okay, the slides that are okay. There are 4 or 5 slides, so let me finish the slides discussion. Fine. So we were discussing this section, Bhaktivinoda Thakur quoting, you know, that Vaishnava is having all good qualities, he's free from all, you know, defects. And he's quoting these verses and we were seeing Prabhupada's explanation in his purport. We were here. One cannot take to Krishna consciousness without being freed from all sinful reactions. So anyone who has taken up to Krishna consciousness is pure. We should see like that. This is how Prabhupada is saying. Naturally, one who is very serious about Krishna consciousness is freed from all sinful activity. Consequently, a devotee is never inclined to commit sins. Now here Prabhupada is speaking about a higher level, you can see here. Naturally, one who is very serious about Krishna consciousness, that means he is at a nashtika stage where the antagatam papam has happened, anarth nivritti has happened. So Prabhupada is speaking here about a higher level. If one is pressured by the law or obligations to give up sinful activity, one cannot do so. So we see that people cannot give up their sinful activities. It's very difficult. However, if one takes to Krishna consciousness, he can very easily give up all sinful activity. This is confirmed herein. So we see, you know, people cannot give up, you know, addiction. There is Alcohol Anonymous Association and, you know, they work very hard, these volunteers, to make people free from, you know, addiction of alcohol. But among their circles, they have a saying, once an alcoholic, forever an alcoholic. Once somebody takes to alcoholism, it is very difficult to give up throughout their life because these habits are very deep-rooted. But Krishna consciousness is so powerful. Somebody takes up to the chanting of holy name, he can immediately give up this so easily. And then Prabhupada quotes this next verse. Agyenena vahaya yadi papa upasthita Krishna tandra shuddha kare nakaraya prashtita. If our agyenava hayadi, a devotee accidentally becomes involved in a sinful activity, yadi papa upasthita, Krishna purifies him. Krishna tandra shuddha kare. He does not have to undergo the regulative form of endowment. Na karaye prashit. He need not go. He need not do any prashit. So accidentally, if he becomes involved in sinful activity, Krishna himself purifies him. And he need not take to the karma kanda process. Srila Prabhupada. Krishna purifies from within as the Chait Guru, the spiritual master within the heart. This is described in the following verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. This is what Prabhupada says. That's it. 11.5.42. So this is Chaitanya Charitamrita 143 verse. So the next verse is 144 and this is being quoted. Swapada moolam bhajata priyasya tektva nibhavasya hari paresha vikrama yachot patitam kadachin dhunoti sarvam ridhi sanyavishta. One who has given up everything, taktva anya bhayavasya, and has taken full shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna. Swapada moolam bhajata. One who has given everything means one who has given up karma kand, karma yoga, jnana yoga, ashtang yoga, and he has taken up to bhakti yoga. That's it. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari Paresha, is very dear to Krishna. So anyone who has taken up to Krishna consciousness is very, very dear to Krishna. If he is involved in some sinful activity by accident, vikarma is sinful. Yat chot patitam kadachin. Kadachin means by accident. The Supreme Personality of Godhead who is seated within everyone's heart, Riddhi Sanyavishta, removes his sins without difficulty. Dunoti sarvam. So this is the glory of bhakti process. So even if devotees, while practicing devotional service, succumb to some sinful activity, this is because of their deep-rooted conditionings, because of their past impressions. And how Krishna purifies, Krishna is saying, I will purify him. This is my responsibility. He will remove this from that heart. And we will, you know, in the next class, go to the heart of Bhagavad Gita. The most confidential and the most confidential knowledge of Bhagavad Gita is the 9th chapter. And the most confidential knowledge is 9.30 and 31. Apichet Sudaracharo, which we will be discussing the next week. If one who can understand this verse, he will never, never find faults with Vaishnavas. He will never see any faults in Vaishnavas. And he who understands this verse, you know, will understand the glory of bhakti and he can attain Krishna. So that we will be taken. But here Krishna is saying himself that one who has taken shelter, he is very dear to me. And even if he commits some sin, Krishna says, I will purify him. So this we should have faith in Krishna's words. Jnana vairagadi bhaktir kabu nahi onga ahimsa yama niyamadi bhule Krishna bhakta sangha. The path of speculative knowledge and renunciation are not essential for devotional service. Bhaktir kabu nahi onga. Indeed, good qualities such as non-violence and control of the mind and senses automatically. Bhule means, you know, they come running behind. Ahimsa yama niyamadi bhule. Accompany a devotee of Lord Krishna. Krishna bhakta sangha. They are behind us. So the jnanis and the yogis, you know, their main sadhana is yama and niyam, control of mind and senses. But Krishna bhaktas, by practicing Krishna Bhakti, you know, these all automatically follow. Prabhupada says sometimes a neophyte devotee or ordinary person thinks highly of speculative knowledge, austerity, penance, and renunciation, thinking them the only path of advancement in devotional service. So sometimes devotees also think that I should become renounced, I should practice austerity, you know. So they think like that. Actually, this is not a fact. The path of knowledge, mystic yoga, renunciation has nothing to do with the pure soul. We should be convinced. When one is temporarily in the material world, such processes may help a little bit, but they are not necessary for a pure devotee of Krishna. So in the beginning, you know, it might be of little help. That's how also Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu Rupa Goswami says. In the material world, such activities end up in material enjoyment or merging into the effulgence of the Lord. So by karma, we go to heaven, and by jnana and ashtanga, we attain mukti. They have nothing to do with the eternal loving service to the Lord. So bhakti has to do with devotion to the Lord, Supreme Lord. If one abandons speculative knowledge and simply engages in devotional service, he has attained his perfection. So that is the glory of bhakti. A devotee has no need for speculative knowledge, pious activity, or mystic yoga. No jnana, no karma, and ashtanga yoga. All these are automatically present when one renders loving transcendental service to the Lord.
Madmatmana, na jnanam, na cha vairagyam, prayo shreyo bahetih.
For one who is fully engaged in devotional service, whose mind is fixed on me in bhakti yoga, the path of speculative knowledge and dry renunciation are not very beneficial. Krishna himself is saying this in the Uddhava Gita. And then this verse, Bhaktivinoda Thakur had quoted, asat sanga tyaga e vaishnavachar, stri sangi eka asadu Krishna bhakta aar. So who is a Vaishnava? Who gives up asat sanga? Asat sanga are those who are attached to women and those who are not devotees. So anyone who has come in the association of devotees, he has given up his, you know, other bad association, he is glorious. He has this wonderful quality. And this we should appreciate. So this is how we should see the Vaishnavas. So this is the next theme, which I will take up in the next class, because it's already time up. And sorry, there was a lot of disruption in the flow of the discussion because of the internet connection. I'm extremely sorry for that. Any questions you have till now what we discussed? We only discussed the verses quoted by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Chaitanya Charitamrita. Any questions or any clarifications you have? Okay then, so we will stop here today. Maybe on Thursday, I will once again cover this topic and then go ahead with the discussion, because there was a lot of disruption in the flow of thought. So I will cover this topic smoothly, and then we'll go to the next topics. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur ki jai. Hare Krishna.